As Ramon mentioned, there are the four books that I've authored, two in philosophy of religion, comparative religion and exploration, and then also two in Mormonism, given my past. If you've got interest in taking a look at any of those, feel free. So without further ado, we get into this morning for you, lecture, Classical Marxism, Cultural Marxism, and Christianity, the Tale of Two Jewish Revolutionaries and the Vision of the Good. In that picture there, we have Marx and we have Jesus, two Jews, the two most influential Jews in human history. Second only to Jesus, Marx is the most influential man who ever lived. I think we forget oftentimes that besides the Bible, the Communist Manifesto is the most sold book in human history. And to assume that Marxism has gone away would be incredibly naive. In fact, it has in many ways merged with Christianity so that you even have books on, you know, Marxism and Christianity. Liberation theology, which we'll talk about a little bit tonight. The infiltration of Marxism into Western thinking called Western Marxism or cultural Marxism or neo-Marxism. This is a picture of one statement, a new statement on our ministry's faith statement, doctrinal statement website. Normally, you don't find this on ministry websites, but it's become such a prominent issue in the West that we thought it is deserving to be on there. So this is recently created. I know that this course today is contributing to a larger course in social ethics. And as I was invited to do that, Ramon originally asked me to speak on critical race theory and Christianity, but in discussing the class, we agreed to go broader and consider the project on social justice, critical social justice that, you know, seems to be successfully making its way toward transforming the West, including within Christianity, through ethical language and an appeal to pity. As you know, in the social sciences, in sociology, it's common to say that knowledge is a social construction of reality. And the way that we construct that knowledge is through language. And so they are about capturing the language to redefine terms and import new and devious meaning. Social justice sounds good, but it is one of the most insidious and pernicious philosophies confronting the West and Christianity right now. We're living in no less than revolutionary times. So our doctrinal statement says, we believe primary human identity lies in being made in God's image. Sorry, I hear someone talking in the background. If you're talking and not up for speaking yet, if you could just mute that would appreciate that. Oops. And then let me drop this down too so I can see what I'm talking about. That would be helpful. So we believe primary human identity lies in being made in God's image, and this bestows intrinsic dignity that is worthy of Christian compassion and justice. Sin is the ultimate problem, and Christ's redemption, the ultimate solution. Redeemed people should promote genuine social justice within a biblical framework. So-called critical social justice is corrupted by a focus on power and privilege rather than truth as the way to understand human relationships. Social justice, corrupted in this way, misconstrues justice, grace, and compassion, and ultimately undermines the mission of the church and its gospel. So we reject as anti-biblical any interpretation of social justice as a meta-narrative inspired by the false components of critical theory or cultural Marxism. This views primary human identity in terms of opposing classes, oppressor and oppressed groups, along the axes of race, class, sex, gender, etc., granting special esoteric knowledge found only in the lived experience of the oppressed. So while the term social justice was initiated by Christian thinkers, particularly in Roman Catholicism, a good book to consider on this matter would be The Concept of Justice. Subtitle is Social Justice Just? And it gets into some of the history of this, but ultimately concludes that it is not. Again, that depends on how one defines the terms, right? And that's why we say particular interpretations. Well, you know, over the last 6 months, I have been part of a study group on Wednesday nights with attorneys mostly studying revolution. We have been reading original primary writings on Marx, on Vladimir Lenin, on Mao Zedong, on the Frankfurt School, the German and Italian revolutions. And we did conclude that the devil is Karl Marx. Okay, not true, but a new book out, The Devil and Karl Marx, not an important connection there. But as we've been studying revolution, it has been rather eye-opening. You know, most revolutions are violent revolutions. The English Revolution was a very, very rare revolution in which it was called the Bloodless or the Glorious Revolution, 1688. Not necessary the way things unfolded. The French Revolution, 1789 to 91, very shortly after the American Revolution, it was a godless and a very bloody revolution. They gave us the guillotine. Not long after the French Revolution came Napoleon Bonaparte. And Marx watched the whole thing really unfold. As a young boy, he and then Lenin after him, they both looked at the French Revolution and thought that is the ideal. The French Revolution was about being godless. They wanted to get so far away from God, they even wanted to have a new calendar starting in 1791, not with the birth of Christ. They took a prostitute, paraded her through the streets of Paris and then into the Cathedral of Notre Dame, and she represented reason and freedom, and they put her on the altar in the Cathedral of Notre Dame. The French Revolution, like the Russian Revolution after, immediately got rid of laws against sodomy and incest. It was a sexual revolution. It was a violent revolution. It was about eradicating the nobility, eradicating the clerics, the church, and thinking itself moving into almost an anarchic viewpoint. But it was a very, very trying time. The Russian Revolution came in 1917, the Leninist Marxist Revolution, the Chinese Revolution, Maoist Marxist revolutions. Now we're talking Marxisms, some different interpretations. The American Revolution, of course, which the French watched, and the discussion went back and forth between Edmund Burke, the father of modern conservatism, in his reflections on the revolution in France, with Thomas Paine, back and forth on whether or not the revolutions were justified. And the American Revolution was violent, but in a significantly different way, had some connections like the English Revolution, but it was a God-fearing revolution. And that raises some questions, though, about the nature of civil disobedience that we could get into later. But then you have some Marxist revolutions that some people might look at as failed revolutions, the German and Italian revolutions. That began in the 1920s and 30s. And I say, I don't know that they were failed. Maybe they just went dormant. Maybe they just incubated and then migrated, which in fact, that is what they did. The only reason they didn't succeed at that time is because they were both dominated by other socialists, national socialists. The USSR flag behind me, the Soviet socialists, global socialists are about the spread of communism. We always had to stop the spread of communism. By its very nature, it is borderless. It's classless, but it's borderless. It is anti-nationalism. And so that's one thing that separates the anti-fascists or Antifa from the Nazis, the National Socialists, is one likes borders, the other does not. One has a certain penchant for blonde hair and blue eyes as well, whereas the other didn't really care about that. But the reason why the Italian and French and German revolutions were initially failures is because they were dominated by the National Socialists, Mussolini and Hitler, but they actually just went dormant. They incubated and they migrated, and they're alive and well today, and we'll get into that. Looking at a video to help those of you think through what you see, because sometimes complicated terms lull us to sleep, they confuse us. You might see something in this video that resonates and you say, whoa, that's what that is? Yes, that's what that is, and that's what we're going to be looking at. We'll watch about 5 minutes of this. And I'm just going to fast forward. He's going into a classroom at a university. And see the terms on the right-hand side of the screen. If those terms resonate, welcome. That's where we're going.
Ignore that. It will end. Now, our first question. 1 plus 1. Yes.
2.
Incorrect. Yes.
Multiculturalism.
Well done, Simon. Next question. What is 3 times 3? Yes.
9.
Wrong. Yes, Penelope.
Gender equality.
Very good, Penelope.
Is this a joke?
Do you think gender equality is a joke?
No, but isn't this a maths class?
Don't be so racist.
I just asked a question.
We don't ask questions. Questions are offensive.
Yeah.
Now, students, I trust you've all completed your research assignments. And remember, the person with the highest mark will be flying to New York to present their paper at the World Mathematics Summit. Well done, Penelope. 6 out of 10. You too, Simon. 6 out of 10.
Hey, be careful. You've been staring at her for 10 seconds.
What?
It's a form of harassment to stare at a woman for more than 15 seconds straight. And when I use the term straight, I don't mean to offend any persons of a non-traditional sexual preference. And when I use the term non-traditional, I don't mean to offend any persons who oppose historically normalized...
Okay, I get it.
Unfortunately, Sunshine, your research assignment is only worth a 1 out of 10.
I've used Fourier transform and mathematical methods in electronics to analyze the electrodiagrams of at-risk patients and calculate their risk of experiencing a heart attack. I mean, it's a new method, but it could potentially save thousands of lives.
7.
You barely even read it.
You used red pen.
What?
Red is considered offensive in many religions.
Why would you belittle everything down to a singular color? Well, humanity is a rainbow of beauty and spirituality.
Yeah. Okay, fine. 7 out of 10, but that still means I get to go to the summit, right?
The marking process isn't over yet. Now, because we live in a society based on equality, the total amount of marks are to be divided equally among our students.
You've got to be kidding me.
Well done, students. We're all equal. We're all average.
Yay!
But then who gets to go to the summit?
We haven't added our privilege points yet. Don't you know anything?
That is correct. Now, Penelope, you are female, so that's +1 privilege point. However, you are white, so that's -1.
But I'm also bisexual.
+1. That leaves you with a total score of 6 out of 10. Simon, unfortunately, you're straight, white, and male.
And cisgendered.
Yes, so that's -4 privilege points, which leaves you with a total score of 1.
It's only fair.
Now you. You're male, and I don't like you. So that's minus 2 privilege points. But you are brown and sexually ambiguous. So that's plus 2. That leaves you with a total score of 5.
Wait, why am I sexually ambiguous?
And finally, sunshine.
I'm gay, I'm trans, I'm Asian. I'm overweight, I'm lower class, I'm unintelligent, unattractive. I've got hairs on my nipples, and I also got body odor, and I can't really run properly or tie my shoelaces by myself. I once watched a pigeon die.
Wonderful, sunshine. That's 13 privilege points. That leaves you with a total score of 18 out of 10. Well done, sunshine. You're going to New York. Hooray, sunshine!
We knew you could do it!
Let me see this. They've just written equality and drawn love hearts on a piece of paper.
He expressed himself, and it's beautiful.
He didn't even spell equality correctly.
We don't discriminate.
This has nothing to do with mathematics.
You think you're so great with your maths and your science and your facts? What about feelings, huh?
Yeah. Feelings are more important than facts.
Yeah!
This is wrong. You're all crazy.
Stop violating me with your different opinions.
I have the right to speak my mind.
No, we have the right not to be offended.
And that's more important. And if you don't stop verbally assaulting us, we will be forced to attack you in self-defense.
Can't do that.
Actually, we have every right to do so.
And it's illegal for you to fight back.
Yeah!
This is insane.
Prepare to die a noble soldier, justice warrior. Welcome.
All right. Does that resonate with anything you are experiencing, seeing in media, academia, or even ecclesia? Well, this is an example of critical theory or social justice or cultural Marxism or neo-Marxism or identity politics, call it what you will. If any of those items are like socks thrown on a wall and it sticks for you, that is where we're going here. When it comes to social justice is a Trojan horse of a term that can mean helping the poor and downtrodden. But most often than not, it means something like economic justice, socialism, reproductive justice, abortion, climate justice, climate change laws. Gender justice, LGBT justice, research justice, not using white or male textbooks. On and on goes the line of different kinds of justices when you divide people up into classes along the axes of race, class, sex, gender, ethnicity, nationality, ability, religion, and so forth. It's about divide and conquer. Now, when we ask the question, what is justice? We go back to thinkers like Aristotle or like Thomas Aquinas, giving to each his due. That's how Aristotle would define it. Now, Aquinas spoke about 3 theological virtues, faith, hope, and love. And he addressed the classical virtues of courage, prudence, temperance, and justice. And interestingly, Aquinas's treatise on faith took 16 questions. On hope took 6, on charity took 24. But on justice, it was the largest section in the Summa Theologica, it took 66 questions. And he defined justice as the perpetual and constant will to render each one his due, getting what you deserve. Justice is getting what you deserve. Now, it may have a broader sense to it, but it certainly cannot be absent getting what you deserve. And when you're having conversations about social justice, they almost never imply that meaning as part of the term. It's always about the redistribution of power imbalance. One of the classical virtues is phronesis. That's considered the master virtue. That's not one of the master virtues. I already listed those. Phronesis is the master virtue for Aristotle, the quintessential virtue. If you have phronesis, the phronimos man, you've got all the virtues on one interpretation at least. It does the functional work as faith does in Aquinas. Aquinas says that without faith, none of the other virtues are even virtuous. It's just that important. But justice, as one of the four classical virtues, is social by nature. So it is no wonder that it was a Christian or a Catholic who first coined the expression, but it's since gone through all kinds of iterations, evolution, through a Marxist paradigm to mean something that it never possibly meant in the biblical text. You know, there is justice in the biblical text. There is compassion. There is grace. There is mercy. Justice is getting what you deserve. Mercy is not getting what you deserve. And grace is getting what you do not deserve. We cannot confuse grace and justice. It undermines the gospel, the very heart of our Christian endeavor and life. But contemporary culture seeks to conflate these together in social justice and say, what would Jesus do? You know, it's compassionate. It's about the poor. So it's an appeal to pity across the board, whether sex, race, class, gender. It's about the oppressed groups. Now, biblically, we can see various characteristics of justice, such as protecting the vulnerable, Isaiah 1:17. Impartiality, Leviticus 19, verse 15. Punishing evil and promoting good, Romans chapter 13, 1 through 4. Micah tells us, what is required of you to love mercy, to walk humbly, to do justice. And justice does have a sense in which it can be connected to what we owe one another by virtue of the fact that we're created in God's image, and I have the right, I have a claim on you, you have a claim on me to treat me well, to treat me with respect as someone made in God's image. But that doesn't mean that our claim extends to my pocketbook. That doesn't mean that that claim extends to taking away my freedom for certain words, for thought freedom, or whatever. Revolutions always take themselves to be just. They're fighting for a just cause. And so everyone involved in a revolution sees themselves on the side of justice in history. But justice, like other ethical concerns, has certain, background considerations, a deeper worldview, a view about reality, metaphysics, a view about knowledge, epistemology, or how we know, and a view about ethics, what we consider to be right and wrong. And we ask questions in that order as philosophers. What is real? How do I know what is real? How should I then live based upon what I know about reality? So to ask questions about justice entails questions about what is the good life? Is there a good life? How do we know it? What is the ground for it? Which entails then questions about knowledge and reality as more basic. And so right off the cuff, and we'll get into this and you'll see how this falls out, but you can analyze Marxism in terms of its view of reality, knowledge, and ethics. It is a godless worldview. And yet Christians now try to baptize it. It is an atheistic worldview at its heart, and its view of human nature is convoluted, sees us as economic man, sees us in terms of social binaries as oppressors and oppressed. In classical Marxism, of course, it's the class warfare. And then how we know things is scientific. Well, so they say. It's through a certain lens that the oppressed classes have special insight into moral considerations because they live the oppressed life and they live under the oppressive regime. And so they can see that one, that viewpoint, as well as their own, and they have certain particular knowledge. And that's where, again, knowledge is a social construction of reality. So you see this video, this man Sunshine, has all of these privilege points in the sense that he's underprivileged. He's in oppressed categories, you know, half a dozen times. And so that gives him the keenest of all insights. And so we might say that knowledge is objective, but it can really only be seen esoterically by those who have special insight into the objective realm of knowledge. So you might think that video was kind of funny, but you also might think it's kind of scary because it dovetails with where many of us are at. Cultural Marxism, is it imaginary conspiracy or revolutionary reality? That's actually a title of an article in a Gospel Coalition piece that I think is a good piece to check out by Robert Smith in the Themelius Journal, International Journal for Students of Theology and Religious Studies. I've followed some of the outlining that he did there because I thought he did a good job, and that can be further reading material for you to go revisit, listen to this lecture again, but go visit that, and I'll be pawning off various reading or podcasts as we go as well. But as we think about this cultural Marxism, imaginary conspiracy or revolutionary reality, you know, Richard Weaver once told us that ideas have consequences. Some ideas are relatively harmless, they're innocuous. Others are revolutionary, a revolutionary for good or for evil. And they're shown so through their histories. Again, Jesus as a revolutionary and Marx as a revolutionary. And it's for this reason that George Santayana, the philosopher, said that those who cannot remember the past are doomed or are condemned to repeat it. This is one reason why history is important. We want to be able to look at, you know, mapping certain movements of the past and evaluating their effects on the present. And it can help us to avoid mines or pitfalls in the future by recognizing them before it's too late. In some cases, it's well too late. Nonetheless, some movements are encapsulated in various terms. They, you know, accrue divisive political overtones, and they can become words that provoke people and come across as having a visceral reaction for disgust or delight, denunciation or celebration. And this is one of those terms, cultural Marxism. It's also known as neo or new Marxism or libertarian Marxism or existential Marxism or Western Marxism. These are various expressions for it, but it's a real thing. You know, I had a Chinese student once when I was in the philosophy department at Purdue. He got sent over here to Purdue University, paid by the Chinese communist government to finish out his last year of his PhD studying Western Marxism or cultural Marxism. So it's not something we're just making up. It's not a conspiracy. Fortunately, he came to Christ through one of our ministries and sent him back on the marketplace in China as a Christian philosopher. So really excited about that opportunity. And that's an opportunity that Ratio Christi affords as we try to reach the universities. But it's alive. You know, what is Western Marxism? What is cultural Marxism? Well, the words may have been coined around 1973, but they have particular meaning. The idea was prior to them. The idea was around for decades and decades before that, and it had its seeds in Marx himself, even though it was a new formal development of Marxism. It refers simply to the 20th century development of Marxist thought that came to view Western culture as a key to human oppression. Western civilization is a key source of human oppression, and that's why, you know, Yale University rejects a $20 million grant that wanted to further extend courses in Western civilization. And they sung, "Hi-ho, hi-ho, Western civ has got to go. It's oppressive, it's colonialist, it's imperialist, and it gets its roots in part from biblical Christianity." Of course, you had worldly people falling under the flag of Christ too. You know, extending their own glory. But nonetheless, there is that connection point. And what's really interesting is if you just right now, you go to Google, you go to Wikipedia and look up, or just Google cultural Marxism and look at the immediate Wikipedia article, it's going to say it's not here. And it'll actually have a little place to send you elsewhere. And it says it's a conspiracy. It's a conspiracy launched by right-wing religious fanatics. This tells you something about Wikipedia as a movement of propaganda. In fact, when I tried to modify some of the entry on propaganda, it got remodified three different times, and then they threatened to kick me off of there. It's a form of media like academia or ecclesia, where cultural Marxism or political correctness might be another way to view this, but not as accurate, has taken over largely. So why the commotion? Well, because people like Jordan Peterson uses the term cultural Marxism, and he's one of the most well-known public intellectuals in the West now, and it comes along to function in shorthand as left-wing ideology. In truth, it's new left ideology, new left-wing ideology, manifesting a various progressive or social justice type cause. And so for that reason, most on the left side with the contemporary culture war. Those that do hear cultural Marxism and think of it as an accusatory snarl word with no validity. But is there validity? Yeah, there is. If we think about introducing Karl Marx into the factor here, that's his date, 1818. Think about the American Revolution, 1776. The French Revolution, which Marx thought was the ideal, was 1789 to 1791. And then about a decade later, you have Napoleon Bonaparte, who died when Marx was just about turning to be a teenager. So Marx was watching this whole thing, and he thought that the French Revolution was the ideal. Marx's parents were both Jewish, and so Marx was a Jew, converted to Protestant Christianity, a liberal form of Lutheranism, so that Heinrich, the son of a rabbi, actually, Marx's father, so Marx's grandpa was a Jewish rabbi, could continue working as a lawyer in German Christian lands. Marx was baptized in 1824. He went to a Lutheran school, nominally Lutheran, and at some point during his childhood, he became an atheist. He studied philosophy under George Hegel, also influenced by Ludwig Feuerbach, and wrote his dissertation on two of the ancient Greek materialists, Democritus and Epicurus. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. And Democritus had the early primitive Lego theory, if you know the toys that you play with that are Legos, that are building blocks, the early atomist kind of theory, but they were materialists. And so Marx took Hegel's views of dialectic, but that was spirit, and turned it into a materialist worldview. He embraced the idea that history follows a natural and inevitable dialectical process. There's a thesis, antithesis, opposing viewpoints, contradictions, and then there comes out some synthesis. And so you've got contradiction everywhere, and there is this economic kind of view of history. So it was a little bit different than Hegel's idealism, which regarded matter as dependent upon mind, and history as the progressive self-realization of the absolute capital M mind. But Marx proposed dialectic materialism, which viewed matter as primary and as change was something inherent in the nature of material reality. He claimed to turn Hegel upside down, or in his words, right side up. And here's how he put it. He said, "My dialectic method is not only different from the Hegelians, but it is in direct opposition. It must be turned right side up if you would discover the rational kernel within the mystical shale." Now, Marx viewed history as inevitably unfolding as an economic history in six stages. You have some kind of primitive communism. It's never really been seen, but he talks about it. Then you have the era of slavery, human slavery that has existed throughout time among all peoples. The only time really that it became a racial slavery was in the transatlantic slave trade, but that was one little blip in human history. Slavery has existed amongst humans for virtually ever. But slavery happens. Then you have feudalism, where you have the nobility and the king, the nobles represent the crown. And that was like the Russian flag behind me. You know, you had 300 years of the nobility in one single family. And Lenin and the revolutionaries took them out, killed them, and revolted and started what was the USSR. But you have slavery, then feudalism, then you have capitalism. And then from capitalism comes this intermediate stage called socialism, which will, according to Marxists, just weather away eventually by its own ways and means. No one knows how or why, but it will just wither away and we will somehow magically float into this communist utopia. So, you know, when people say that communism has never been tried, in one sense, they're kind of right. Everything we see is a version of socialism that never makes it past that intermediate stage. Maybe you get there through Castro in Cuba or, you know, North Korea or something like that. But the criticism even of the USSR was that it was a socialist country ruled by a communist party. Even the Soviets would say that themselves. You know, every time the experiment going in that direction has been tried, it's been bloody. It has been the road to hell. But in one sense, okay, fair enough. Communism has never been tried. We still have faith that it will come. It is about the good life. It's about a vision of the good. And, you know, when I think about this, when Marx diagnoses the problem, when I first took a graduate course from a distinguished professor of Marxism at Purdue University, and I read through Das Kapital, The Capitalist, I remember feeling that bleeding heart, that sadness of some of the abuses that were going on during the early parts of the Industrial Revolution. And the working conditions were quite paltry, unhealthy, dangerous, and exploitive in some respects. Consequently, he says that wealth inequality soared as the industrialists made excessive profits, while denying the workers sufficient income to flourish. So this concept in Marxism was surplus capital. The capitalist worked to death the workers and developed and exploited them for their own capital that they didn't work for. If you remember, Obama during his presidency said to Joe the plumber, it became famous on commercials, "You didn't make that, you didn't build that business of plumbing." And this is what he meant by that, because Obama was trained in Marxism. The capitalist didn't earn what he has, right? Because in communism, there's this idea, or socialism better yet, that the slice of, or that the pie is finite and it cannot grow. Anyone who has more slices of the pie than someone else got it unjustly. Inequality entails injustice across the board. It's the zero-sum game. If you grow, someone else has to lose for you to grow. That's the socialist's idea. And this led Marx to view the fundamental human problem through two lenses, through oppression and alienation. The worker gets alienated not only from other people and not only from his livelihood, but also from his very self. You know, through this capitalist endeavor, the capitalist class or the bourgeoisie, as those that own the means of production, they use and abuse and exploit the working class to make profits for themselves. Man is alienated from his own humanity. And so if the problem is oppression, the goal is liberation. If the problem is alienation through oppression, the goal is salvation through liberation. And it's always from the group or class standpoint, ergo group justice or social justice. So, you know, though capitalism had intensified this problem at the time, Marx contended that the problem itself was nothing new. History had been about the inequalities of the rich oppressing the poor. That's what history was about. In his outline of a solution, he was convinced that the capitalist system contained the seeds in it of its own destruction. It continued exploitation of the proletariat or the workers by the bourgeoisie. It's going to mount to resentment, and this would eventually and inevitably boil over into a proletarian revolution, in which case the bourgeoisie would be violently overthrown, out of which a new classless society would finally emerge. Now, we're never told how this happens. It's just supposed to happen. See, this is one of the predictions of World War I. They were getting ready to revolt. The workers were getting ready to revolt, right? It's the early 1900s. And he thought, here it comes, here it comes. Wait for it, wait for it. They put on their boots.
Yeah, I know. That means...
They put on their boots, and instead of revolting, they went to war with each other. And the Marxists sat there and said, what in the world just went on here? What happened? The predictions didn't happen. And it's that development that got us into neo-Marxism. But they had no thought given to, you know, what's going to happen with the proletariat dictatorship once socialism takes over, once you have that revolution. It's called the dictatorship of the proletariat. The assumption is that those new workers, they're not going to become the capitalists. They're not going to be the ones in power. They're not going to abuse that power and oppress other people because somehow they're now good. Well, how does that even happen? Have you ever seen Castro or Kim Jong-il or Mao or Lenin or Marx or Stalin or any of those guys, once they revolt, suddenly level the playing field and everybody lives in the same tent? No, of course not. Patrice Cullors of the Black Lives Matter movement just bought $4 million homes. Mao owned an entire nation. That never happens. And they never tell us how this is supposed to happen, and they never give answers to this. They just say, we'll figure it out along the way. So Marx's dialectical materialism inferred that the transition from capitalism to communism would be unstoppable to a natural evolution of the material forces of production. But it never happened. You know, some people say that, this is all, once again, a conspiracy. But the communists never were conspiratorial. Marx said that communists disdain to conceal their views and aims. They openly declare that their ends can be attained only by the forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. Let the ruling classes tremble at a communistic revolution. The proletarians have nothing to lose but their chains. They have a world to win. People, this is not a conspiracy. You just read what they write. They tell you, for something to be a conspiracy, it has to be a secret, right? The Communist Manifesto is the second most sold book next to the Bible. And Chairman Mao said, a revolution is not a dinner party. Now that said, not all revolutions are violent. Marx famously said at the end of the Communist Manifesto, working men of all countries, comrades, unite. Between the time of what he called revolutionary terror and the arrival of a communist utopia, a transitorial government of the working class, the dictatorship of the proletariat, would be necessary. And elsewhere, he makes clear that this intermediate state is what he means by socialism. So when you use the term socialism, we don't always use it in the correct way. But what it has in common is that there will be bloodshed. All the bloodshed would be worth it. You cannot make an omelet without breaking eggs. There are going to have to be heads that roll. After capitalism's demise, a truly humane society would appear and governed by the principle, from each according to his abilities, to each according to his needs, which Marx and Engels talked about deriving from Christian thinking. So, was Jesus a socialist? Was the early church socialistic? Some people believe that. A lot of millennials do. This is why I quote, the theory of the communists, Marx says, may be summed up in the single sentence, abolition of private property. Because when you look at the New Testament, you look at, say, the book of Acts, chapter 2, or Acts, chapter 4, they brought all they had together in common, and they distributed it, so there was no one with need. From each according to their ability, to each according to their need. Communism is about the abolition of property, because Marx viewed people with property are people with power. People with wealth are people with power, are people with privilege. Privilege entails power. It's always those in power who are the oppressors, always. And so we need to revolt. We need to level the playing field and go after equality, because everything is about inequality to equality, right? There's a Beatles song by John Lennon, who I call the evangelist, John the evangelist Lennon, Vladimir Lennon's twin, called Imagine. Now, it was the number one single song in the last 50 years. It's almost 50 years old now. And he admits that it was anti-religious, anti-nationalistic, anti-conventional, anti-capitalistic, and yet it sold because it was candy-coated. But that was his intent behind it. In Lenin's gospel is Marxist ideology, prioritizing chronologically the criticism of religion, then the criticism of politics, and then the criticism of economics. In that order, the way that Marx looks at it, religion is the ultimate one to go. So imagine no religion, no heaven and hell. Imagine no country, no borders, no nationalism, Antifa, nationalism, no possessions, sharing everything in common, no property. We'll listen to this song and we'll take a break because I know you want to listen. Now look at the words so far and what we've talked about. Protests at the time.
No religion to
the cause of it all.
Imagine all the people.
It's for the People's Republic.
Living life in peace. You may say I'm a dreamer.
I'm not alone. Everyone's doing it.
But I'm not the only.
Join the movement, comrades.
I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will be one.
Unity.
Imagine no possessions,
no property, no oppressors.
I wonder if you can.
Just try it. Greedy capitalists are the reason for the starving children.
A brotherhood of man.
Equality, equality, equality.
imagine all the people sharing all the
just like the early church.
You may say I'm a dreamer,
it's a vision,
but I'm not the only one.
A lot of us believe it.
I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will live as one.
You ready to join the movement? From Marx to Lenin, and John Lennon, not just Vladimir Lenin. All right, let's take a break. Ramon? You're on mute, Ramon.
All right, I'm unmuted now. All right, before we go to break, let's take a class picture for this course, so we can see the universals there, abhansomeness and beautifulness. And with Dr. Corey. So turn on your cameras. You should be expecting this now. So I know it's early morning in the Philippines, but hey, we gotta turn on the cameras to take a picture. And if somebody can do screenshots, I'm just gonna take my phone. Quick. Now don't turn on your mic though. All right, everybody smile. I don't see some of you. Some of you are not showing up their faces. Look at this way. All right. Okay. Before we go to break, any questions, guys? Comments, questions, thoughts? Imagine.
I have comments. First, I appreciate Dr. Corey for being patient on reading Das Kapital, knowing that Das Kapital has two volumes, and there is what we call the Grundrisse, which is the unfinished work of Karl Marx. And just to inform you, I am having these thoughts actually, you know, that about the consequence of Marxism in developing countries such as our country. As you all know, there is an ongoing Marxist insurgency here in the Philippines, but I happen to be one of them before. I actually, it's kind of complicated because the activists here, the leftists, the so-called leftists here in the Philippines are under their umbrella, but they're kind of denying, you know, but in reality, they are connected to the CPP, and they're connected to the Communist Party here in the Philippines. And the thing here is this, without these Marxists, there are some problems in our country that would never see daylight, such as the rampant corruption of our government in our country. They are the only ones who are so vocal about it. You know, there is there'll be no critic if these movements don't exist. So my question now is this, what do you think is the alternative that concerned people could do in order to present a counter narrative to the narrative that is being presented by communists? Because some of their some of their ideas are actually, you know, captivating because it kind of relates to the reality, especially developing countries like ours.
All right, thank you. Dr. Miller?
Yeah, I mean, so as a secular viewpoint, you know, I love Aristotle. He was one of the philosophers that I did my PhD on, and I can learn from him. I enjoy reading Marx. I enjoy reading David Hume. I can learn from them, but it doesn't mean I imbibe all that they teach. You might say chew the meat and spit out the bones, but you have to say, what are the bones, right? If you're going to bypass the bones and not choke on the bones, you've got to bypass the bones. Well, as we'll see shortly, a lot of the, you know, leaders of the various Marxisms, and there isn't just one, and some of you made that note in your comments too, they portray accurately that at its essence, at its core, it's atheistic. But let's suppose it's not. Let's suppose we can chew the meat and spit out the bones, and one of the bones that we can just bypass, we don't have to swallow, is the atheism. That's a negotiable part. Well, that's a good question. Its read, because of its atheism, has a certain understanding of human nature and the human telos, or the end, the goal, the purpose, even though it would read very much like Richard Dawkins in A Darwinian World, there is no purpose, no good, no evil, but blind, pitiless indifference. Nature neither cares nor you know, is concerned about you. And yet we have this Marxist idea of a utopia, of a arrow going in one direction, as if there is a correct way to go, right? That progress by its very nature is progressing towards something, toward some good. But from whence comes the good? I mean, there is no ethic in the jungle. The lion doesn't look at the gazelle with a bloody foot and offer a first aid kit. There's no justice there. There's only the strong survive. And in this case, it's about the strong collective surviving. We can do more together. And as Marx is famous for saying, philosophers have historically interpreted reality, but the goal is, after all, to change it. So he's a social activist. And yet within materialism, you're hard pressed to even have free will, much less ethics, to be able to assign someone praise or blame, to be able to praise someone for being on the way, on the right side, on the just side of history. Marxism can't make sense of justice. It can't make sense of free will activism. It can't make sense of economics. It misread economics. It woefully predicted where things were supposed to happen, how they were supposed to happen. And at the end of the day, Marx wasn't an economist. And as we'll see, he wasn't very much interested in economics and in some respects in the poor. He had an agenda. He thought he had it worked out how it's supposed to happen, and his later followers have morphed it. It has evolved, some better and some worse. But still, what are the bones of Marxism? If we're going to chew the meat and spit out the bones, especially we'll see this later tonight or today in your case when we get to critical race theory or critical queer theory or critical pedagogy or critical this or critical that, critical, criticize the heck out of Western values from individual rights to equality in favor of equity. There's no individual. Marxists hated the individuals. They were about the collective, the group. And that's why everything is assigned group power dynamics. It repudiates, as we'll see, the virtues of the civil rights movement. And in America, it's taking us backwards right now. It's a very good question. Althusser, is that how you pronounce your name?
Yes, okay. Doctor.
It's a good question. I think it really requires we find out what the bones are, because we don't want to swallow a bone. So the idea that we can chew the meat and spit out the bone, Marxism is by its nature, by its founders and its major movements, antithetical to Christianity. And we'll get into some of the biblical passages here in a little bit to look at some of the central features of that. But I guess I would say that for now, but I guess we better take a break.
Yes, it would be an in-depth discussion.
It would. There's a lot there. There is a lot there. Yes.